Some people would say Christianity's exclusive. You're right, it is. Some people think, you know what? Oh, I'm just a legacy Christian. You know, my parents were Christians, my grandparents were Christians, my great-grandparents were Christians. I was raised in a Christian home, so I'm a Christian. No, being raised in a Christian home doesn't make you a Christian any more than walking into your garage makes you a vehicle, all right? Some people think, you know, I go to church, or I was baptized, or I prayed a prayer, or there's ignorance. Nothing really happens after life. We all just turn into worms. Those are all lies that people believe. See, some of you are here today, and boy, one of the struggles is that you're like, man, I just don't understand how Jesus could love me. And you've given up on yourself and you've given up on others, but I want to tell you today that God hasn't given up on you.
Welcome to Shelter Cove Online. We are so glad that you're joining us today for this sermon. We hope and pray that this message encourages you, that you learn something, that you enjoy it. But more than that, we just pray that God would move in your life, that he would reveal some more of himself to you today. If you would like to respond to this message in any way, you can contact us at sheltercovelive.com. Have an amazing rest of your day.
Yeah. Hey, so glad that you guys are here with us today. My name is Jeremy, one of the pastors here. And if this is your first time here, I just want to say welcome. Stoked to have you here with us today. Also want to give a shout out to those of you joining us in the loft. Also those online, great to have you with us today. Right now, if you have a Bible, meet me in Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. If you don't have a Bible, you're okay. We have you covered. Raise your hand and one of our ushers will get one to you in just a moment. We are wrapping up week three of our vision series. And what we're doing today is we're getting super practical about our heartbeat as a church. Now, our mission statement is reaching and raising authentic followers of Jesus. And that really comes out of the Great Commission, where Jesus said, go into all the world and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and surely I will be with you to the very end of the age. And so that comes right out of the words of Jesus. And then our vision is that every one will know him. And the one comes right out of the passage we're looking at today, Luke chapter 15. When we talk about a one, we're talking about a lost person, somebody that doesn't yet know Jesus Christ. And my prayer for every single one of you that call this your home church, and if you're not there yet, I pray that today you would say, hey, I want Shelter Cove to be my home church, is that you would have a one in your life, a boy, a girl, a man, a woman that does not yet know Jesus Christ, and you would be intentional in your prayer efforts, in your time, in your priorities, that God would use you to lead this person to Jesus Christ. So super excited today as we get very practical on how to do that. A couple of weeks ago, we set the stage on who we are as people. Jesus said, you're the salt of the earth. You're the light of the world. In other words, you are to make the world and the earth better and brighter. Last week, we talked about what we do as people. We are loving. We're gracious. We're people that have experienced that from God, and we allow other people to experience that through us. And then today what we're talking about is reaching your one. How do you reach your one? Now, Jesus is going to share a parable. It's a story to challenge the thinking of the religious people in his time. So would you stand as we honor the reading of God's word? We are a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church. And standing is simply one of the many things we do to honor his word. Luke 15, starting in verse 1. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him, speaking of Jesus. And the Pharisees and the scribes, those were some of the teachers, the religious elite of the day, grumbled, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. So he told them this parable. What man of you, having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Heavenly Father, God, would you just have your way in our lives today? Open our hearts wide. Open our ears to not only hear what you want to say, but receive what you want to tell us. And would you make us new? Make us different. Again, make us into the people you want us to be. God, I pray for your help, God, that you would speak through me with clarity, with passion, with boldness. God, we want to hear from you today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Go ahead and grab a seat. Grab your message notes out. Great way to track with message today. And then also on your chairs, there are a couple resources when you walked in. One says the vision that everyone will know him. We're going to be walking through this, some of it at least a little bit later. This is a great resource for you. And then my one, we're going to go ahead and talk about that at the very end of the message. How to reach your one. And really, this is my heart for all of you. And I say that because I believe it's Jesus's heart for all of you. And we're going to do something we normally don't do here. We're going to teach this passage backwards. We're going to start at verse 7 and go all the way up to the beginning, because I believe that's going to really allow us to understand the heart of Jesus. So how do you and I become effective at reaching the ones, the people that are lost in our lives? The one is somebody that doesn't know Jesus Christ. Spiritually, they're lost. I believe there's three things that we need to do. Number one is simply this. We need to understand the gospel. We need to understand the gospel. The gospel is simply the good news of Jesus. And to understand the good news, you have to understand the bad news. But this is what it says in verse 7. Verse 7, Jesus says, "Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents." I love that word, repents. "Than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." This word repent is not something that a lot of churches talk about. A lot of churches don't have this clear understanding of the gospel. Repentance is a change of mind that leads to a changed heart that ultimately leads to a changed direction. And we're gonna talk about the bad news. First, the bad news is that we are messed up sinners in desperate need of a savior. And the Bible talks to us as lost, and we're compared to sheep. Now, the best way to illustrate this would be for us to get a sheep on the stage. So will you please join me in welcoming Alaska the sheep to the stage? Come on, church, show her a little bit of love. Come here, Alaska. We got Becca, the owner, coming up here too. Alaska's really friendly. Alaska and I are like BFFs right now. Yeah, yeah. Alaska, tell me, did you like the worship this morning? Yeah, it was good. It was good. Hey, do you think Victor's an amazing worship leader? Huh? Is Victor an amazing worship leader? You can tell me. Do you like Victor? Yeah. Okay, now look at these people. Are these people, are they all weird? Yeah, I know they are, huh? They are. So what do we know about sheep? Because Jesus used this story to describe sheep. Everybody knew what he was talking about. Sheep would wander. Sheep were followers. Sheep could easily get lost. When you think about sheep, they're defenseless. They could get attacked easily. Not only that, they can't see very well. They can't hear very well. They're very weak. They can't run fast. They're a little bit smelly. Just like some of you, but they're precious, and in the midst of them being confused, being lost, all of that kind of stuff. What are sheep? Sheep are very precious and valuable in the eyes of Jesus. And Jesus says, "Boy, if I've got 100 and there's just one that's lost, would I not love it enough that I would chase after it, even when it talks back to me? And would I not go after the one that is lost?" And you know what he does? He puts it on his shoulders. And he cares for it, and he brings it home. Oh, you want me to hold you, don't you, Alaska? All right, we're going to let Alaska go back. Give a round of applause for Alaska right there. Go ahead, Alaska. We're pretty much BFFs now, in case you haven't noticed that. And I love this because Jesus talks about going after the one that's lost and putting it on his shoulders. and grabbing hold of it and bringing it home. And I think about this great example of being saved and eternally secure, because here's the picture of Jesus, this lamb on his shoulders. And what is the lamb doing? Lamb's licking me and getting stuff all over me. What is the lamb doing? The lamb's just hanging out on Jesus' shoulders. The lamb's not holding on to Jesus. The sheep's not holding on to Jesus. Jesus is holding on to that sheep. In other words, you're eternally secure when Jesus saves you. Don't miss this. Because it's not based upon the fact that you're holding on to Jesus, but Jesus is holding on to you. John chapter 10, John chapter 11, Jesus talks about the fact that he is the good shepherd, and he lays down his sheep, and he won't let go of his sheep. And I want to walk you through some familiar verses for some of you, maybe newer for others, of some verses in Romans that lets us know the gospel. Again, the gospel is simply this word for good news. And it's in your little pamphlet that we've got you, but I want to start with Romans chapter 3, 23. It says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." All of us are sinners. We fall short of the glory of God. So turn to your neighbor right now and say, "That includes you." All right, we just want to make sure we're all on the same playing field, right? We're all sinners. We're all messed up in need of a Savior. But this is the next verse. The next verse in your little pamphlet, Romans 5, 8. "But God shows his love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us." Don't you love that? He didn't wait for you to get your life together. He didn't wait for you to try to clean your life up. Why? Because you never can. You know, some of you have a house cleaner, and you're crazy enough to try to clean your house up before the house cleaner comes. You know what you do? You come to Jesus as you are, in your mess. Why? Because in your mess, there's a message. All right, Romans chapter 6. Paul puts it this way. It says, "For the wages of sin is death." In other words, what you and I earn, what we deserve for our sin is death. Eternal separation from God in a place called hell. He says, "But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, our Lord." Somebody once put it this way: salvation is a gift you receive, not a paycheck you earn. Goes on, Romans chapter 10, it says, "If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." I love that. It's crystal clear. Well, it's a heart issue. It's not a special prayer. It's not anything like that. It's a heart that recognizes what? That recognizes that we're messed up, that we're sinners, that we can't save ourselves, and that we acknowledge that we're sinful. So what do? We repent. We turn from our sin. We turn from ourselves. We turn to Jesus. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the only one that can save us from our sins, from ourselves. God sent Jesus Christ to this earth. He lived a perfect life, a sinless life, proved that he was God in human form, went to the cross in our place for our sin. What did he do? In his love, he takes our sin upon himself and experienced the wrath of God for our sin. So that when we put our faith and trust in the finished work of Jesus Christ, we will be saved. And what did he do? He died. And he rose 3 days later, proving victory over sin and over death. Now, here's some misconceptions that people have when it comes to how we're saved. Some people think, you know what? Oh, I'm just a legacy Christian. You know, my parents were Christians. My grandparents were Christians. My great-grandparents were Christians. I was raised in a Christian home, so I'm a Christian. No, being raised in a Christian home doesn't make you a Christian any more than walking into your garage makes you a vehicle, all right? It's a great thing to have, but that does not save you. Some people think, you know, I go to church, or I was baptized, or I prayed a prayer, or there's ignorance. Nothing really happens after life. We all just turn into worms. Those are all lies that people believe. You know, some people even believe that, you know, God is so loving that he would not send anyone to hell. That's a partial truth. But anytime there's a partial truth, it's not true. The reality is that God does not send people to hell. People choose it. Because at the end of the day, we will either choose or reject Jesus Christ, the only one that can save us. See, there's some people that think, you know what, I'm just a good person. I'm a good person, so I'm going to get in. Let me encourage you with this today. You're not. In fact, if I could describe you, it would be awful, terrible, disgusting, a disaster. I could go on and on and on. It's the same way I would describe myself. And here's what happens when we are free to recognize the fact that we are sinners in desperate need of a Savior, that we need to no longer pretend to have it all together. You know why? We don't. But we serve someone who does, and his name is Jesus. And so instead of pretending, we can be authentic and real about the struggles we've had and the struggles we're having, knowing that Jesus Christ is powerful and able to heal us and cleanse us and purify us from all unrighteousness. So we no longer need to pretend, but also it gives us a depth of security that's only possible with Jesus, because we recognize and realize there's no way we could save ourselves. So when we realize how messed up we are, it's actually a freeing thing. I love what Tim Keller says, famous pastor that's gone home to be with the Lord. He said, the Christian gospel is that I am so flawed that Jesus had to die for me. Yet I'm so loved and valued that Jesus was glad to die for me. This leads to deep humility and deep confidence at the same time. Keller also put it this way. He said, the gospel is this, that we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet, at the very same time, we are more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we'd ever dared hope. That's the good news of Jesus. We're so messed up, but even more than that, we're loved. You know, some people will say, you know what? All paths lead to God. That's not true. There's one path, and it's through Jesus Christ. A couple of verses that describe that are, first of all, John 14:6. Jesus said to him, I'm the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Some people would say Christianity's exclusive. You're right, it is. There's one way to God, and it's through Jesus Christ. Jesus put it this way in Matthew. He said, enter through the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction, and those who enter by it are many. For the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life, and those who find it are few. It's a couple roads. One's wide, one's narrow. The narrow road leads to Jesus. Other people will say, you know what? I'm going to contribute to my salvation. And there's nothing we can do to earn our salvation. Let me put it this way. Jesus doesn't need your help. He did it at the cross. The work is done. In fact, I love what it says in Ephesians chapter 2. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, which means we receive it or reject it, not a result of works, so that no one may boast. See, the first thing that we need to do is we need to be people that understand the gospel, the good news. Because when we look at ourselves, there's nothing but bad news. And the good news is Jesus. Second of all, what do? Share your story. Share your story, your God story of how you came to know Jesus Christ. Every single one of us have a story. And if you're here today and you don't yet have a relationship with Jesus, I pray that today that God is rewriting your story so that you would know him in a personal way. It says this in verse 5. It says, and when he has found it, speaking of the sheep that was lost, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and his neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep that was lost. Here's Jesus sharing the story of the sheep that was lost. Now it's our turn. We get to tell our story of being the lost sheep that was found by Jesus. See, what makes this powerful is we can have a heart for lost people. We need to have a heart for lost people. And I pray that you have a heart for lost people. But what makes this powerful is when you realize that lost sheep, that one, if you're walking with Jesus now and you're saved from your sin, that used to be you. You were the one that Jesus put on his shoulders. You were the one that was lost. You were the one that was wandering. You were the one that didn't know your way home. And Jesus loved you enough that he came after you. See, some of you are here today, and boy, one of the struggles is that you're like, man, I just don't understand how Jesus could love me. and you've given up on yourself and you've given up on others, but I want to tell you today that God hasn't given up on you. There's nothing he will do to stop pursuing you because he wants to save you from yourself and save you from your sin. And so what we can start doing is we can start telling our story of how we met Jesus. And there's a couple different components to it. And this again is in your little pamphlet, which is awesome. Take this, read it. What was your life like without Jesus? For some of you, it was hopeless. It was helpless. Some of you had relational disasters. You were sexual addicts. You were promiscuous. You did anything and everything. Some of you were in prison. Some of you were angry. Some of you can fill in the blanks, but your life was a wreck without Jesus. And then when and how you met Jesus. Man, you were invited to church. Man, a friend loved you enough that they shared with you the gospel. God's trying to share the gospel with somebody right now. Their alarm just went off, right? You were invited to a men's retreat, a women's retreat. You had parents that loved you. Whatever it is, it's that day that you met Jesus and you gave your life to him. And how is your life different with Jesus? Man, you've got peace in your life. You've got perspective in your life. You've got hope in your life. Your worry is not what it used to be. You still maybe worry a little bit, but not what it used to be, because you know that no matter what happens, you're going to be with Jesus. And some of you've got these crazy, awesome testimonies and stories. I used to say, man, my story isn't very crazy and it's not very interesting. What makes your story and my story special is it's unique to you. You know, I've got a pretty bland story, I think, but I'm so thankful that God spared me from so much pain and suffering in my life. I was born and raised in a Christian home. My dad was a pastor and I grew up and, you know, went to church and had my shirt tucked in and tried to look spiritual. And I realized later in high school and college, when I could go out and do whatever I wanted, that I had more of a religion of Christianity than a personal relationship with Jesus. Because I grew up and the whole mindset was, I just want to please mom and dad. And I realized later in life, no, my primary object of praise and pleasing needs to be Jesus. And I started walking with Jesus and talking with Jesus, and I had a friend that came into my life named Mark, and he started talking to me about the things that normally you don't talk about when you're a college guy. And he talked to me about girls. He talked to me about pornography, and he talked about living this life that ultimately would honor God. And God got a hold of my life. But I remember when I was 6, 7 years old, I gave my life to Jesus Christ, and God just began to change me from the inside out. And he's still working in my life. But that's my story, and everybody has a story. I love what 1 Peter 3:15 says. It says, but in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone for the reason for the hope that you have or that is in you, and yet do it with gentleness and respect. You know what the greatest defense is? It's your story. It's the way you live your life. Now, here's what's so important. Your story needs to match your lifestyle. In other words, one of the greatest reasons why people are turned off to Christianity is we will say that we are a follower of Jesus, but our lifestyle and our speech does not match up our talk and our story. So people should see something and say, man, I've noticed there's something different in you. Man, the way you talk, you're not as worried as much. You're not pacing back and forth in the office as much. Like there's something different about you. You know, I was on Facebook the other day and there was a reminder of a picture of Drew when he was like 2. And here's what it is. We were at the state fair and there he is, 2 years old, little Drew. And then I posted a picture recently of him this year from a couple days ago. Here he is, 17 years old. And I got quite a few messages of, oh my goodness, he's so big. Oh my goodness, he's so grown up. Now, can you imagine if I posted a picture of Drew and said he was 17 and he looked like this? Go back to the last picture for a second. Look, he's 17. You know what you would say? That's weird. That doesn't make sense. Here's the point. When we share our story, people should say, man, there's something different about you. There's something different about the way your life looks. Go ahead and take that picture down. And some of us might be thinking, you know what? Well, how do I even start a conversation with somebody? First of all, make sure you establish a foundation where people know that you love them. And you ask them, hey, how's your family doing? How are your kids doing? You find out what sports. You find out, oh, they love golf. Hey, did you get a chance to go golfing this weekend? Because what's important to them becomes important to you. Start talking. They realize, man, this person cares about me. This person loves me. They really. And then what do? You find a time where you can take them out to coffee or take them out to lunch, and you just have a casual conversation. You just say, hey, I never really told me your story. Tell me about your story. Where'd you grow up? And you even ask them questions. What was life like as a kid? And they start talking some more. And you can ask more questions just to show you're interested and care. Why? Because people love talking about themselves. Play into that. And then when they're done sharing their story, there's a very good chance they will say, what's your story? And boy, you were teed up to share about your story and your life and how as a kid your life has fallen apart because your parents got divorced and it was a mess and you had dating problems and whatever your story. But then you met Jesus Christ. And Jesus Christ has changed you. And you're not perfect and whatnot, but boy, you're experiencing a changed life because of Jesus Christ. And boy, it really just sets the stage for you to be able to share your story. Now, a couple thoughts. First of all, people are like, how do I do this? First of all, just don't be weird. All right, there's too many weird Christians out there, right? Where people are like not drawn to Jesus because of us. They're like scared of us. You know, so just try not to be weird. All right? And then second of all, don't be so afraid that you say nothing. Here's I want to get underneath a fear that some of us have. Some of us are so fearful of saying the wrong thing, not having the right answer, coming across as awkward, where we absolutely do nothing. And let me just pastor you for a moment. Here's why that's so concerning for me. Is that you are more concerned about how you look and how you're perceived than caring for lost people that are going to hell. In this season, would you be willing to take a risk? Would you be willing to embarrass yourself for the sake of somebody else that you love them that much? You know, I've had so many times where I've said stuff and had conversations with people where I'm like, oh, I leave. And I'm like, I will never say that again. I'm not going to do that. In fact, just this last week, I was at the gym talking to somebody. I'm just really trying to hang out with a dude that's just yoked big, had a hoodie on. I'm like talking to him. I'm like, bro, man, you look good. And I think he took that the wrong way. You know, I'm like, gosh, all right. He's like, you're not bad yourself. And I'm like, man, hopefully I had my ring on, you know? I think you got the wrong impression, you know? I'm still trying to figure it out, but I'd rather be embarrassed. Then think about the people in high school, my junior year and senior year, where I said nothing and did nothing. And some of those people I will never have the opportunity to talk to again. Why? Because I was fearful. Because I was concerned more about how I looked, how I was perceived, what people thought of me, than caring about the fact that these people are dying and going to hell. So what would it look like for you and me in this season to say, God, we just want to understand the gospel. We want to share our story whenever it's possible. And for some of you, man, it's going to be a conversation where you're sharing your story for 20 minutes. Other times, it's going to be a quick summary, a minute and a half. But I want you to practice your story and know your story and be comfortable sharing your story. And then thirdly, in your notes, love lost people. Here's why this is so important. Point one and two mean nothing if you can't do this. You can know the scriptures, you can know the gospel, you can know your story, but if you don't really care and love lost people, it's not going to be effective. You know, just this last week, a couple days ago, I was driving home in the afternoon, and my wife said, hey, I went on a walk earlier today, and I can't find Leah's pacifier. It's the pacifier that's attached to a stuffed animal dog, and it like hangs in her mouth, and there's like a dog snuggling with her. And she's like, here's my route. And she's like telling me her route. It was like 2.5-3 miles. And I knew it because we've walked it before. So I'm driving around looking for a pacifier on the sidewalk. Why? Because it was important to her. And I love my wife so much. And here's what happens. Like, what's important to her becomes important to me. So I'm looking around for this stuffed animal with a blue pacifier hanging out of his mouth. Couldn't find it, you know. Comes, you know, later that night, my wife's like, hey, by the way, I found the pacifier. It was on the floor next to the bassinet. I'm like, oh, glad you did. I said, I'm glad you did. And inside, I'm like, great, I wasted part of my life looking for that thing. Here's the point. It was important to her. It's important to me. Stand up here, and I'm a changed man. I'm a Raider fan. I've been a Raider fan for 10 years. Some of you are applauding. Others of you are like, man, I knew that guy was a sinner, right? Some of you are like, he's my one right now. But why am I a Raider fan? Because I've got a friend, a really good friend that's a Raider fan. And the more I hung out with him, the more the things that were important to him became important to me. Don't miss this. Why do I want us to be a church that has a heart for lost people? Because Jesus has a heart for lost people. And what's important to Jesus, that's what's important to us. Jesus said in Luke chapter 19, 10, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. Now here's where the religious leaders of the time missed it. Verse 1 says, now the tax collectors and sinners were drawing near to Jesus. There was something about these sinners that felt comfortable around Jesus. Why? Because he loved them. He cared about them. And it says, and the Pharisees and the scribes, those were the religious elite of the time, grumbled in saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. Here's some religious leaders. These guys, they knew what the scripture said. Maybe some of them even had the Old Testament memorized. But they didn't give a rip about lost people. See, here's one of my greatest concerns for us is that we will know what the Bible says and we will think that's what defines us as spiritually mature. No, you want to be spiritually mature, you grow in your obedience and your love for lost people because that's the heart of Jesus. Then he says this in verse 3 and 4. He said, so he told him this parable, what man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it. I love that. And this is where we get the one that is lost. It says, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one. It's our vision right there. Why? Because it's lost. Perishing. Doesn't know its way home. You know, I've heard people say, lost people know they're lost. No, they don't. Lost sheep didn't know it was lost and had no way of finding its way home. That's why Jesus went over it, lovingly grabbed a hold of it, put it on his shoulders and brought it back home. What would it look like for you and I in this season to be the hands and feet of Jesus? To go after lost people the way Jesus Christ relentlessly goes after us. And here's what I love. It says, until he finds it. Again, persistence. Again, a never giving up attitude. We don't give up on others because Jesus Christ never gives up on us. Oh, that we would be a church that knows the gospel, that shares our story, and loves lost people. And I think the only way that this is going to be powerful is if we're mindful of the fact that at one time we were the one. So I look back at my life, and not only did my dad lay a spiritual foundation, Mark Wilson poured into my life when I was in college, but Michael Cordato and Mike Harrison were a couple guys in my small group when I was in college, and they helped me understand what a personal relationship with Jesus Christ was all about. When I was in college, I got involved in just serving in ministry with a guy named Darren Schock, and he let me know also what a personal relationship with Jesus Christ was all about. And so when I get to heaven, man, I'm gonna just bow on my knees and on my face in the presence of Jesus, but I'm gonna look for Mike, and I'm gonna look for Mike, and I'm gonna look for Mark, and I'm gonna look for Darren, and I'm gonna look for my dad, and I'm gonna be thank you. Thank you. Because without you guys, I don't know if I'd be here. Here's my prayer for Shelter Cove, is that God would use you in such a way where heaven is packed because of you. And there are people that come up to you and say, I would not be here if it wasn't because of you. Remember when you shared your story? Remember when you came and visited me at the hospital? Remember when I was anxious and depressed and you gave me a hug? Remember when you fill in the blank? So here's what I want you to do right now. I want you to fill in a different blank. Get out your white card just for a moment. We're gonna wrap with this. I want you to write down a name of your one, a lost person in your life. And if you need to pray, you can take a moment to pause and pray. And for some of you, you already know who it is. It's a friend, it's a family member. For some of you, you have no lost people in your life, which means this next week you need to join a pickleball club, a bowling league. You're gonna join a tennis league and you don't even play tennis. Why? Because your priorities are going to change because you realize you just need to be around some lost people. But write down somebody's name. And here's what I want you to do, twofold. I want you to pray for them every day this week. And you put this in your Bible. You put this in your wallet someplace. You will see it every day. You pray for them every single day this week. And here's what I want you to do. Just do something. Just do something. Buy them lunch. Bring them coffee. Start some conversations and find out a little bit about their kids. Bring them some cookies. Mow their yard. Do something this week that takes a step in the right direction. Why? Because you have a heart for somebody that's lost and you want God to use you to lead them to Jesus Christ. Would you stand with me? In the loft, would you stand with me? I'm gonna pray for you this week. Heavenly Father, as we leave this place, we go in your love and in your grace and in your strength and in your power. And we pray that you would give us your eyes to see and your heart to love. God, that your attitude for sinners and lost people and sheep that can't find their way home be our attitude. And that we would go after people until they are found. Would you burden our hearts like never before for the one? We love you. And we pray that you would give us a boldness and a confidence that only comes from you. Give us some opportunities this week. In Jesus' precious and holy name we pray. Amen and amen. Church, I am beyond excited about this upcoming season. God bless you guys, and we will see you next weekend.